Okay, well, thank you. Good afternoon. I'm delighted to be here. A little bit about me. Like many in the permaculture movement, I have a rather unconventional background. I started off studying religion and philosophy, specializing in the Indian traditions, and started off as a gardener. That's how I got into permaculture, and eventually made the full transition, and I'm now at the Center for Agroecology, Water and Resilience at Coventry. You hopefully will have come across our stand here at the conference. The Center for Agroecology at Coventry is probably the best place where you could do research in permaculture in the UK. Okay, I thought I would start by going through some basic definitions. It actually took me many years to come across this. Very often we use words without knowing their origin. And if you look at two key words, agriculture and arable, the Latin meaning is very revealing about what they're about. So agriculture comes from the Latin ager, which refers to fields, and therefore refers to the management of fields. Not forests, but fields. Arable, even more interesting, comes from the word arare. Of course, being Italian, I do have an advantage in this, which literally means to plow. And in Italian, a aratro is a plow. So this tells us a lot about what arable farming is about, you know, what its basic characteristics are. It involves tillage, cultivating the soil, some kind of farm tools. It involves fields as opposed to forests or different types of vegetation. And it's dominated by grasses, by annual plants. Given that we've been here for 2 days, I'm not going to, you know, teach you or tell you about definitions of permaculture. But I just thought I'd provide a couple of basic definitions which I'm sure many of you have come across. And these are the basic definitions I'm working with as a basis when I talk about arable permaculture. Particularly the second one, the conscious design and maintenance of agriculturally productive ecosystems modeled on natural ecosystems. So, one of the things which I noticed when I got into this field was that there is an internal debate in permaculture, but also in the other alternative agricultural disciplines, a debate about agriculture itself. I've put a few quotes which I found particularly interesting, also quite amusing. For example, gambling about the plain and forest, hunting and living off the land is fun. Farming is not. Now, of course, I would dare suggest maybe they haven't been to the right farm, or perhaps they found hunting really easy. Similarly, sustainable agriculture is an oxymoron, Hemingway. There's also this sense in which there is a clash between agriculture and nature, as if agriculture is intrinsically unnatural. There's something not natural about it. 10,000 years of conflict between agriculture and nature. I could have gone on with many other examples, but there's certainly a current of thought, a trend in the permaculture movement, which sees something intrinsically problematic with agriculture itself. There are certainly some arguments in favor of this. I've offered a few, which a synopsis of some of them. The first, I guess, goes back to the whole issue of aratro, the plow, i.e. that continuous soil disturbance, the turning of the soil, is not something which happens very often in nature. Of course, we can talk about the hoofs of animals disturbing soil and allowing seeds to germinate. But generally speaking, the annual continuous disturbance of soil is not something which happens commonly in nature. Also, perennial plants tend to dominate most mature ecosystems, whether in temperate climates or tropical or Arctic, perennials tend to dominate. Monoculture is also very uncommon in nature. As we saw in other talks, polyculture is based on the very premise that nature does not work by monocultures. There have also been quite a few what I would call socio-political, historical arguments against agriculture. Anthropologists and historians and so on have argued that the adoption of agriculture historically has led to increased malnutrition, poverty, disease, etc. Similarly, it's led to greater inequalities, societies with great hierarchies, more conflicts, war, and lastly, some have noted that very often agricultural societies run out of land to grow enough food to feed themselves, and it's led to expansion and imperial cultures. To these points, I will point some counter arguments. The first one is yes, soil disturbance, annual soil disturbance is not that common in nature. But of course, there's a big difference between different methods of cultivating. You know, the extent to which it's cultivated, the method used, and of course, the consequences vary enormously. I think the annual and perennial divide is sometimes unhelpful. There are, of course, many annual plants in nature. It seems to me there is nothing intrinsically less natural about an annual flower, whether it's cultivated by a human or not. Nothing less natural about it than a perennial. Third point, of course, going back to the issue of polyculture, an arable farming system does not necessarily involve monoculture. Of course, you wouldn't know this if you went around the British countryside, if you went to East Anglia and all you saw was miles and miles of barley and wheat, but arable farming has not always been about monoculture. There are some examples of sustainable farming systems, historically. One of the points which I missed in the early slide, I just realized, was that there have been historical failures. For example, the Fertile Crescent is often mentioned as an example of a place where agriculture started very early and then effectively failed. It's now not so fertile, lots of desertification. The same pattern is true in North Africa. But there are also many examples of the opposite, i.e. parts of the world where agriculture seems to have worked and not depleted the not depleted the fundamentals of sustainability, fertile soil, etc. I'm not going to get too much into the latter points, the socio-political issues, but it seems to me disease, famine, or malnutrition and poverty are not, not the sole characteristics of agriculture. That many societies did not practice agriculture, both now and in the past, which have had the same problems. Similarly, for inequalities or hierarchies and conflicts, of course, the scale and complexity of conflicts differs between hunter-gatherer societies and agricultural civilizations. But nonetheless, it seems to me human nature is more of an issue than which way the humans get food. The same is true for the latter point. It's true that all empires or all imperial cultures also practice agriculture, but does that mean that it's the cause? Not necessarily. It could be a necessary condition, but not the cause. So, arable permaculture. I put a question mark, because this is still a concept I'm trying to define. I go back to the definition of permaculture I used at the beginning. By definition, it must be a system which has the same resilience and characteristics of a natural ecosystem. So it needs to fit into that fundamental definition. In terms of an arable system, given that it's based on, as we saw earlier, fields and grass, it should be basically modeled on natural ecosystems which are dominated by herbivores. And of course, around the world, we have many examples, from the grass plains of North America to Central Asia, etc. And of course, even in this country, many examples of ecosystems where grass and herbivores coexist in symbiosis. It has to be a mixed farming system. So again, our conventional arable farming that we have now in the UK will not fit that criteria. It's not a mixed farming system. It's not integrated. The crops are not grown with animals side by side. I think it should include an important perennial element. So whilst annual crops may be one of the main outputs or one of the main sources of nourishment for the society, it should include perennial elements. I mentioned agroforestry, orchards, hedgerows, etc. An integration of perennial and annual, very important. Also, I think it should remain connected with the other primary activities. It's not as if when humans took up agriculture, they suddenly forgot how to fish, hunt, and gather. In fact, in most agricultural societies, traditionally, at least before the industrial age, you know, a good farmer was also a good gatherer. You know, he would have seasonal hunting, fishing, etc. And of course, horticulture. Most farmhouses would have still have a garden. So the farmer does not abandon those activities. He just no longer relies on those as his main for his livelihood. So a basic model, and I'm thinking of England mostly, but of course this could apply to other temperate climates or other parts of Northern Europe. It would have to be centered around this idea of herbivores and grass and arable fields, these three elements all combined. Cultivated grasses, so cereals and legumes, would dominate, but also many other annual crops, many of which have been almost entirely abandoned, and many others which could be introduced. In England, we have a few precedents. There are a few examples in England which could be a guidance for now and the future. During the Agricultural Revolution, some interesting crop rotation systems were introduced, such as the Norfolk four-cross rotation. It was very common to fold animals on arable land. There was a real connection between growing crops and keeping livestock. And on the whole, some of the elements of a sustainable agriculture were there. So we wouldn't be starting from scratch. So a little bit about my own project. I've gone on a bit too long. I work at the Bhaktivedanta Manor. This is the headquarters of the Hare Krishna movement. There's a farm with over 100 acres of land. Most of it is grassland, pasture, but there are 9 acres of arable land. I'm in charge of 4 of those. This is a commercial farm to a certain extent. You know, it's part of the movement. So its main goal is to provide food for the farm kitchen, for the community. We have a farm shop, etc. I've been there for over 3 years now. I've introduced a number of crops, I'm proud to say. This year, introduced grains for the first time. Broadly speaking, I like to think that my arable system is modeled on some broad permaculture principles. Briefly, apart from some of the more traditional methods in arable farming, such as crop rotation, I've also been trying to experiment with polycultures on a field scale. In the early talk, there was a discussion about polyculture and scale. I'm trying to do polyculture on a very big field scale. A complete dependence on livestock, and this is not just in terms of fertility maintenance and manure, but also the actual using of draft animals. So this is one of the very few farms in England where we actually use animals to cultivate the land. the complete exclusion of any conventional industrial methods. I think we go way beyond the organic standards too that outlined in the Soil Association. The inclusion of perennials, which I talked about earlier. So to give an example, my field is generally a sloping field. It's a 4-acre field up on a hill, a small hill. And in the lower part of the field, I've got a sort of perennial strip, which acts like a sponge. So we get lots of water runoff during the winter. So I've got this perennial zone with things like chicory, which has very deep roots, and other grasses, and other perennials, which, as well as providing outputs, act as a sort of sponge. So again, observing the local environment, the characteristics, hydrology, and so on, and acting accordingly. Okay, a few examples. I mentioned grains. I've introduced this here. I guess one of the distinctive features between, say, the way I'm trying to grow grains and most organic farmers is I'm using ancient varieties, which are really, really tall. They're man high. I'm not very tall, I know, but possibly taller than me. But these are really, really tall varieties, very hardy. They don't, they have no, basically no competition with weeds. They grow extremely fast and tall. So ideal for a system where you're happy to coexist with weeds. They produce a lot of, less grain, but good quality, but lots of biomass, lots of straw, which is both food and fertility. It's gone in rotation, and I've also experimented with other, what you call false grains or pseudo grains, such as buckwheat there in the middle. Legumes, very important. I think they're one of the least grown crops in the UK, and they should be, we should grow much more of them. Very important for soil fertility, pollination, and of course nutrition. I found that winter legumes seems to be the best for local conditions. Again, it's about trial and error. Also lots of fodder crops, which are legumes, so vetch, important fodder crop, sown just about now and then harvested in the spring. I was really keen to show you this. When I first got into permaculture, I got really obsessed with the Three Sisters method. I just found it such a neat form of polyculture. By show of hands, who's come across the Three Sisters method? Okay, no, I thought so. Okay, so there's a few variations. There is also a fourth sister snuck in sometimes. She could be tobacco or sunflowers. My goal was to say, could we do this on a field scale, from seed? Seems to me like the outputs would be phenomenal. You could have a grain crop, the corn. You could have a legume if you actually choose to use a legume. You could have sunflower, an oilseed crop, and then, of course, squash on the ground. And squash could be a fresh vegetable crop, also a fodder crop. I think it's got phenomenal potential as a fodder crop, both the seeds and the actual fruit. So far, mixed results. Every year is improving. This year, I think I found the best combination. And the beans had to go. To get them to climb on a field scale was quite problematic. So it's squash, sweet corn, and sunflower. I hope next year or maybe the year after, I'll come back with some interesting yield figures. This could be a really good example of a polyculture, very high yielding on a field scale. Fodder crops, I'm not going to go too much into this, but suffice to say, in this system, the idea is not to grow, is not to use crops which are really for human consumption, i.e. grains to feed cattle, which are herbivores, so they shouldn't be eating grains. The idea is that, yes, there are some dedicated crops for the livestock, but also livestock are really fed on all kinds of agricultural waste, all kinds of biomass, which we cannot eat. So the arable fields provide a lot of the food for the animals, but in a way in which we're not taking anything away from the primary goal of the arable farming, which is to provide food for people. Just a few pictures. I felt I did not put quite enough pictures in the early part of the presentation. Here are animals eating that really mixed fodder, lots of different plants in that fodder. Some of my brassicas, that's father and son actually, and holding our turnips and our radishes. These are good examples of a dual-purpose crop. You know, we eat a lot of these through the winter, but also we feed them to animals. Very important crops. Animal draft I touched upon. I know this is very peculiar, and this is probably the only agricultural conference where this will not be seen as really, really out of touch and odd. In fact, I hope some of you are quite enthusiastic about this. So yes, we use animals to cultivate the land. This does many things for me. I mean, apart from integrating on a very real practical level the cultivation of crops with the herbivores, it's also, it really does reflect that idea that I'm trying to recreate an ecosystem dominated by domesticated plants and animals. I've actually got herbivores on the field, their manure goes on the field as well as their labor. There are, of course, many common objections to this, which have to be taken seriously. It would take a huge societal change to convert to the use of draft animals and abandon machinery. I do not believe some of the objections are fair, such as it would take food away because draft animals would need to be fed purposefully. Of course, draft animals have to be fed, but like other farm animals, they can also be eaten. This would not happen at the Hare Krishna farm, so I have to make this very clear in case my colleagues get hold of this presentation and think I'm promoting the consumption of our animals. We do retire them, but my model ideally could be adopted on farms where, you know, the oxen might end up in the Sunday roast. A valid option, of course, which does not quite fit into this model, but for people in permaculture, would be to use on-farm made biofuel or alcohol. That could be another option for the arable farmer. Arable farming will require energy to till the soil. And if we're talking about what I call an arable permaculture system, apart from animal draft, which would be the ideal, I think the only other option is to have energy produced on-farm. Again, a few pictures. Your humble servant is there with the hat. And we also use them for our festivals and general transportation. But in that particular picture, we're harrowing the field before or after seeds. There is a yoke, which we make ourselves. I know I've only got 1 minute left. I wanted to finish on weeds. Weeds are inevitable. Any annual system on arable field, they literally follow the plow. In my system, yes, they are a management issue, something which I have to keep in mind all the time, but it should not be seen as a problem, of course, both from a, shall we say, philosophical point of view and a practical point of view. How do we manage them, or how do I manage them? Apart from, of course, in some cases, cultivation, one of the purposes of plowing is to bury weeds so I can put my own seeds in. Some of the interesting ones is we use them as fodder. So apart from two weed varieties, all of them are edible. So sometimes we just harvest them. And you know, our oxen are very spoiled and picky, so if they eat them, they must be pretty good. We also use them as food. There are two weeds, fat hen and pigweed or amaranth, which, believe it or not, we harvest through all the growing season and we sell. And they're very popular in the Indian community. They're really delicious. I can honestly tell you they're as nice, if not better, than, say, spinach or chard. And they grow by themselves. The last point, I put it here sort of at the end because it kind of encapsulates a lot of my ideas. These two weeds, amaranth and fat hen, are really also guidance for the farmer because they grow by themselves on this field. So that tells me that the cultivated varieties, which are quinoa, because fat hen is wild quinoa, and amaranth, which of course is also a grain crop and a vegetable crop, should grow really, really well on our field. And this year we've tried with, last two seasons actually, we tried with amaranth, and it grows really, really well. So we've looked at which plants thrive on that soil in that environment, and then we say, okay, we're growing domesticated annuals. Perhaps we can take some guidance from what grows without our assistance and use that guidance to grow our crops. What's going to be interesting is the amaranth is already crossbreeding with the wild variety, so we should end up with our own local variety. So that's really exciting. So, conclusions. I do believe I'm a big defender of agriculture. I do believe it is the fundamental activity of mankind. I do not see a clash with permaculture necessarily. It depends on what agriculture we're talking about. What agriculture can do, though, is provide a real critique of what's wrong with agriculture. It can provide a way forward to reform rather than eliminate agriculture. As we saw in other presentations over the last 2 days, a lot of traditional farming systems do practice permaculture. They just don't do it consciously. There are permaculture practices within traditional agriculture which are done without the awareness that they are permaculture. So what permaculture can do is provide a way to really to both innovate, but also keep what's best and what's worked and what is sustainable. On that note, thank you for your attention, and I'll be delighted to take questions. And sorry, last but not least, I'll be very happy to get people to visit the farm. So after the presentation, if you want to come see me, exchange contact details. I'm very evangelical about what I do, so I hope to see some of you on the field. Thank you.
So, time for questions and reactions. Just before the coffee break.
Hello. Yeah, my name's Ed Sears. I was discussing with somebody over lunch about how would we replace industrial field scale grain growing. I think you've touched on some aspects of that, how to make a grain growing work on a mixed farm. I wonder if we need to sort of also consider how we tackle the very large scale industrial grain farming that you'll see in, for instance, Russia or America or Australia.
Sorry, so your question is how could we address the large scale industrial growing of grains in other regions?
If we suppose that the supply of fossil fuels is going to contract, so that those forms of agriculture aren't possible, where do we go in terms of replacements?
Okay, right. Okay, there's a few approaches. One, of course, is I think we should grow less grains. So whether we're in England or North America or other traditional regions where there's lots of grains growing, I think we should grow less grains. So there is scope for example, converting a lot of arable land in places like the ones you've mentioned, say North America, converting them back to grassland, and then keeping some of the best land for arable to grow grains, but also other crops. I really do believe potentially the use of animal draft could be a solution for many parts of the world, and as I said, biofuels as well, but provided and not from crops grown just for that purpose. My understanding is, in the United States, until about a century ago, many farmers did produce their own alcohol on farm, often from crop waste. So they would, of course, in those days farmers had lots of orchards and apples and other things. So very often with the surplus or the waste, they would make their own alcohol, put it in the tractor and use that. So yes, it's a huge challenge if oil and gas are no longer available or diminishing, or we just choose not to use them. Then it's a huge challenge because we need energy. And as I said, the ways I would tackle it is less cultivation, less grains, and then the two alternatives, which are animals and on-farm energy. But there are no easy solutions.
Maybe just One last short question and short answer, if because we.
You haven't touched on the delicate subject of eating meat or eating less meat. Obviously, you don't want
I
to
do
eat
actually.
Lots of meat. Oh, you do? Okay. But how do you think that comes into your scheme of things?
In my scheme of things, I think it's eating meat is perfectly compatible with an arable permaculture system. In fact, because, to my mind, the integration between livestock and arable is so important, you know, by default, meat would be one of the outputs of the farm. So unless you have moral or religious reasons, such as like the Hare Krishnas, not to slaughter animals, you inevitably will have the possibility of eating meat as well as dairy and other products. Of course, I think if, say, in the UK, we had a countrywide adoption of this sort of methods, we probably would end up producing less of certain types of meat. There would be less poultry and less pork, for example, I think. Perhaps not pork, but certainly poultry, because there wouldn't be quite so much cereal to spare for the right feeding to animals. But there certainly would be huge scope for eating herbivores. So I think beef or lamb or etc. would still be major parts of the diet. So my view is, if animals are fed sustainably, i.e. on crop waste, all the things we cannot eat, and of course grass, herbivores are meant to eat grass, then I really don't see any contradiction. Of course, it has to be nose-to-tail eating, not in the way we eat it now. But for me, no, it's not only, to me, vegan farming or the idea of vegan agriculture is very problematic. I don't think it's really it's not really compatible with this sort of view, or even with permaculture.
So thank you. I really want to thank the three speakers for their interesting talks and contribution, and also thank you for your attention and reaction. So maybe we can keep discussing with a coffee or a tea or water or anything. Thank you very much.